knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
So far in this series, we have learned how a crime scene and evidence are processed in some detail. But you may be wondering, where do we actually apply the Sherlock brain and try to understand how the crime occurred? Crime scene reconstruction, or CSR, is where we try to guess the events that may have taken place during a crime. This is not a simple process, like some shows and movies make it out to be. All the stages we have studied thus far culminate in CSR. Though we are presenting CSR as a part of evidence analysis, it is a process that begins in the mind of the investigator upon preliminary survey of the CS. This is called a mental reconstruction of the crime. The investigator forms a general theory about the crime by analyzing the CS pattern carefully and observing the location and position of all evidence. But whether this theory should be accepted or refuted will depend on the successful interpretation of results obtained from evidence analysis. Imagine solving a large puzzle, but you don't have a picture of the puzzle to begin with. You don't know how the finished product is supposed to look. Let's make it even harder. You don't have all the pieces of the puzzle either. So now you have to describe the complete picture from roughly 40% of the pieces. Pretty tough, right? Well, this is how reconstruction works. The more pieces of the puzzle you have, the easier it is to understand the picture. Evidence are the pieces of a puzzle at a CS. The more evidence collected, analyzed, and interpreted, the greater the chance we can understand the events of the crime. This is why we are studying reconstruction as a part of evidence analysis. Now that we understand the logic behind CSR, let's look at its definition. CSR is defined as the forensic science discipline in which one gains explicit knowledge of the series of events that surround the commission of a crime using deductive and inductive reasoning, physical evidence, scientific methods, and their interrelationships. From this definition, we can understand that there are three major pillars that form the foundation of CSR: reasoning, physical evidence, and scientific methods. It is by studying their relationships that an investigator could be able to answer questions like, who was involved with the crime? Why, when, and how was the crime committed? We will look at each of these pillars one by one. The first is reasoning. It includes applying logic and reason to discern the events of the crime. We mentioned two types of reasoning, deductive and inductive, while studying the law of probability. Deductive reasoning is when we make an inference from commonly accepted facts. For example, it has rained, therefore the road must be wet. Here we have concluded that the road must be wet because it is a fact that water will wet the road, and rain consists of water. In contrast, inductive reasoning is where we make observations and come to a more general conclusion. For example, the road is wet, therefore it must have rained. Here, it is not necessary that the conclusion must be correct, but it is the most plausible one. The road can be wet due to a tanker spilling water as well, but rain is the most plausible explanation here. The investigator uses both types of reasoning while investigating a crime. The second pillar of CSR is physical evidence. We have already discussed the importance of evidence, so there is no need for further explanation here. No evidence, no investigation. The third pillar of CSR, perhaps the most important one, is the scientific method. The stages of CSR are nothing but just an application of the scientific method. Let us understand this in detail. This method broadly consists of five major steps. The first step is to make observations and identify a problem. The second step is to research the problem by studying previous literature related to this subject. The third step is to create a hypothesis regarding the question. The fourth step is to test the hypothesis by collecting and analyzing data. The fifth and final step is to draw conclusions from testing. This step is where one interprets the results obtained from testing and infer whether the hypothesis is accepted or refuted. Critical thinking is the most essential ingredient in the scientific method, as the end product is the generation of new knowledge. Let us consider a research question. Does drug abuse influence sleep patterns? In researching this topic, we'll have to study all the previous literature and form a hypothesis. Yes, drug abuse does influence a person's sleep patterns. Then we will have to collect data related to drug abuse and sleep patterns from a sample of the population. By analyzing the data, we will understand the correlation between these two variables. In the last step, we'll interpret the results. Two types of inferences are possible. Either the relation will be established or not. However, in both cases, we are contributing newer knowledge in this subject. Let's see how this is applied in reconstruction. The first stage of CSR is data collection. This includes all the information recovered from the CS, the victims, the suspects, and the witnesses involved. The most important stage will be documentation using techniques like note-taking, photography, sketching, and videography. The condition of the evidence and the victim are noted. Witness statements are recorded and compared with the documentation made at the scene. At this stage, the information collected is reviewed, organized, and analyzed by studying their interrelationships. The next stage of CSR is conjecture. It is defined as an opinion or conclusion formed on the basis of incomplete information. The data collected in the earlier stage is incomplete at this stage because the evidence has not been analyzed yet. However, the investigator needs to form an opinion regarding the crime based on this incomplete and limited information. Why is this required? Why not wait until the evidence gets analyzed? Isn't forming an opinion on incomplete information a bad thing to do? Well, evidence analysis cannot proceed until the investigator communicates their expectations to the laboratory. How would they communicate these expectations unless they form a crude opinion about the crime? If a bullet is sent to the laboratory, it will be sent to the ballistics division. But what if fingerprints and blood are also to be recovered from the bullet? How can the laboratory decide to do this unless the investigator communicates as much? This is why conjecture is needed. It helps to form a general explanation regarding the sequence of events of the crime. One thing to remember here is that the conjecture is not the only explanation of the crime. It is just a possibility, and it makes room for other possible explanations as well. The third stage of CSR is hypothesis formulation. A hypothesis can be defined as a supposition or proposed explanation made on the basis of limited evidence as a starting point for further investigation. This sounds very similar to conjecture. After all, both involve making assumptions. However, there is one fundamental difference between conjecture and forming a hypothesis. While conjecture is formed before submitting the evidence to the laboratory, a hypothesis is formulated after the preliminary results of the evidence analysis are obtained. The investigator visits the scene again, goes through all the documentation of the scene and the evidence, studies similar cases, and makes an assumption about the crime. Therefore, if the conjecture is simply a guess, a hypothesis is more than that. It is an educated guess about the possible sequence of events of the crime. The next stage of CSR involves testing the hypothesis. In this stage, the hypothesis is tested by further rigorous analysis of evidence. The results are compared with control and blank samples for successful interpretation. The physical activity that may have transpired during the crime is repeatedly performed in a controlled environment to test the hypothesis. The suspects can also be carried to the scene to reenact the crime. Pattern evidence, which includes fingerprints, footwear prints, gait patterns, glass fractures, tool marks, and bloodstain patterns are the most important while determining the sequence of events. They are to be tested meticulously under controlled conditions. Let's look at some examples. If the firearm-specific rifling marks on a bullet are recovered, the same type of bullet is shot from different firearms to determine the firearm it was originally shot from. The injury patterns made by the bullets on a body can be compared with the injury patterns made on ballistic gel using the same firearm. This can help us determine the range of fire or what distance the bullet was shot from. Similarly, all the evidence is tested. Once the hypothesis has been tested, we move towards the last stage of CSR, which is theory formulation. Here, all the data from different steps of CSR are placed together, reviewed, and verified. All the pieces of evidence collected from the CS are a result of different small event segments. Consider an accused shooting the victim with a Beretta M9 pistol. In this case, the gait pattern and footwear impressions of the accused up to a distance of 10 meters away from the body will be one event segment. The fingerprints of the accused on the firearm will be the second event segment. The bullet recovered from the victim will be the third event segment. And the matching rifling marks on the bullet will be the fourth event segment. There can be many such segments, but for the sake of understanding, we will limit the discussion here. So, from these distinct event segments, we can conclude that the accused shot the victim using a Beretta M9 pistol from a distance of 10 meters. These event segments are associated together in a theory by corroborating them with information obtained from documentation and accounts from the witnesses. This theory will be the most plausible explanation of the sequence of events of a crime and concludes the process of reconstruction. It is finally documented in a detailed analysis report by the investigator for distribution to the higher officials and presentation in the courtroom. The report not only mentions the evidence and material used for reconstruction, but also states if there are certain facts and circumstances not known to the investigator. This report is signed and verified by at least two examiners. This helps in providing a fresh perspective on the reconstruction and also highlights gaps in the process, if any. With that, we conclude our introduction to CSR. On the part of the investigator, observation skills and a logical approach play a major role. On the part of the laboratory, proper scientific ability to analyze the evidence matters most. From this point forward in the series, we will be discussing different types of evidence and their processing in detail. We will also try to understand their utility in reconstruction and include relevant case studies. The next tutorial will be about the last stage of investigation and the only one that takes place in a courtroom, expert testimony.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.